Hi everyone, I am Jennifer Bishop from the Toronto Region Board of Trade. I'm glad you could join us today. We've got a great panel, another one of our series during COVID. Today is the activation special. We've got the fantastic Brent Roots from the Partnership Group joining us. We've got Jennifer Fries, the VP of Partnership at TIFF. And then we also have John Winwick. He's the VP of Community Initiatives at ATB Financial. I will hand it off to you, Brent.
Great. Thanks very much, Jennifer. Thanks, everybody, for being here. And thanks for the opportunity. This is actually the third session that the Toronto Region Board of Trade and Jennifer have put forward. And it's greatly appreciated. Thank you, Jennifer, for making this all happen. And thanks to the Toronto Region Board of Trade for being the host here. So it's a great opportunity. This is a great session too, and I'm really looking forward to it. Looking at creative approaches around sponsorship activations. That's the discussion today, because as we come out of isolation slowly and the return to economic prosperity, hopefully, as we move forward, how is that going to look in all our sponsorship programs, whether we are properties, whether we are agencies or whether we are brands and sponsors? How can we envision and look to the way activation is going to work? I've got two great panelists here, and I'm going to let them each introduce themselves. And Jen, I'll start with you, and tell us a little bit about who you are and what you're with.
Perfect. So my name is Jen Fries, and as the other Jen mentioned, I am the Vice President of Partnerships at TIFF. We only have blonde Jens on these calls. That's the way it's been arranged. So I've been with TIFF for close to a decade now and have been leading the Partnerships Group for about half that time. The Partnerships Group is comprised of the Hospitality Partnerships Team, the Event Partnerships Team, which includes all of our amazing partner film festivals across Canada and around the world, as well as, of course, the Corporate Partnerships Team, Sales and Accounts Divisions.
Over to me, Brent.
Go ahead, John.
Okay, yeah. John Winwick with ATB Financial. We're the largest financial institution in Alberta, about 54 billion in assets, 300 branches. We've been around for about 80 plus years. Very active in the community. I would say the one thing that we are known for is we're a purpose-driven organization. We believe that by basically doing good things in the community and building your brand that way, that the business will follow. So sponsorships, our corporate social responsibility division, all the above play a very prominent role in our company and what we do in the community. So that's quick high level of ATB.
Great. Thank you both for being here, and thank you for the opportunity. And of course, thanks to everybody else, to the almost 200 people, 175 people that are on this call and this opportunity. So here's just a quick layout of where we're going to go and how we're going to approach this. I would encourage everybody, as Jennifer Bishop had mentioned, please keep your mics turned off, because barking dogs in the background tend to throw people off, that sort of stuff. But also the fact that on the right-hand side, there is a Zoom group chat area if you want. So if you just put your cursor down the bottom of your screen, there's a little chat button there. If you click on that, you'll get a chat bar on the right-hand side. Feel free to type in any questions you may have. I will try to monitor it, but I'm not really good at multitasking and doing that. So Jennifer Bishop is also going to watch those as well and see what we can pull out to make sure that we're answering those questions. I do have a series of questions for Jen, and I have a series of questions for John. And if we get through all of them, great. But as Jen and John and I have talked about, if you guys have a ton of questions, and that's where this leads off to, because this is about you, if that's where this leads off to, then we'll go there. But the plan will be is to ask Jen a question and then answer anything that's also in this chat area, then move on to John and back and forth like that. So feel free to participate in that manner. So Jen, I'm just going to start out that the fact that a few years ago, so this would all be pre-COVID scenario, but a few years back, TIFFs shifted the way they did partnership activations. You actually told partners, just because you're a car company, a auto manufacturer, you can't just put a car in here and have an enter to win draw. You need to do something that's focused on the audience here at TIFF, and that is around film and movies and that side of it, because that's your audience and they need to be appealed to. Can you tell us a little bit about that, why you went there and how it's worked out for you and for your partners and your audience?
Yeah, absolutely. That was a big band-aid to rip off, in all honesty, because it was a dramatic shift from what we had been doing previously. And I will say it was a dramatic shift to what many partners had seen in other organizations. You know, we just really recognize that we have a very engaged tastemaker audience. They tend to be very highly educated, very discerning. And quite frankly, they were expecting really premium experiences and they wanted a holistic TIFF experience. And so we recognize that our audiences were responding best to our partners who were enhancing that film going experience as opposed to detracting from it or trying to sort of divert attention from the main purpose why they were attending TIFF. So what we're noticing now is that our best activations are, they're really starting with audience experience problems. So we're asking our audiences, we talk to our audiences all the time and ask them, you know, what's not working for you? What are the challenges that you're facing in your entertainment experience or in your TIFF going experience? And then we work with our partners on how to fix it. That tends to be at really the core, actually, of all of our most successful asset development moments. And really, when we started doing that, we saw exponential increase in audience engagement, specifically in our Festival Village and definitely online, plus obviously stronger survey results, and really kind of proving to them that it's important that the partners are there. The partners are really adding something here, and they're not there in sort of a traditional promotional capacity. They are part of the TIFF experience at its core. And so now we have this rule. You have to showcase, as part of a partner of TIFF, a partnership with TIFF, you have to showcase a love of film, a film culture, and really show up as a hero to our audiences with your brand activations.
Hey, that's terrific. So, John, I mean, as a brand, and at ATD, you're doing events like, I mean, obviously you're not at TIFF, but you're at CIFF in Calgary, Calgary International Film Festival. Tell us what sort of activations that you've undertaken in the past and some of the larger sponsorships that you've been involved with so that the audience tuned in here knows a little bit more about that.
Sure. You're cutting in and out, Brent, a little bit, just as a heads up, but I got the drift of your question. So for us, what we are looking for in any activation is that it's a memorable experience for our customer, or even better, our prospect. So we work on, obviously, brand recognition as one of the key components of any sponsorship. But it's that memorable experience that we can deliver to a customer when they're at an event. And I'll give you an example. We work with a local blogger who does amazing social media event, and we created what was called the ATB Listens Lounge. And so instead of people showing up to a conference and sitting in their seats for an hour and a half, you know, then you get a 15-minute break and then another hour of... What we did is we said to all the participants, if you tweet us during this event, number one, social media presence with the tweets. The second component was we would start to interact with the people in the crowd. And we said, we want to fulfill one of your wishes. And so it got as ridiculous as somebody said they wanted to pet a puppy. And we went to the SPCA, got a puppy, brought it back, put it in a pen, and let the customer, obviously the customer was blown away that we would do that. They tweeted it, others tweeted it. It was just a unique experience and probably one of the largest activations in terms of social media we've ever had. So from an experience standpoint, for us, it's all about a surprise and delight scenario, something that people will lean over the fence with their neighbor the next day and say, hey, I was at this ATV event and this is what they did. So we're looking for something always outside the norm, something unique that people haven't seen. So certainly in these days, it's interesting to try and figure out what to do, but that's some of the stuff, Brent, we've been doing in the past. That's a little bit different than your normal activation.
Great, thanks. It's interesting because as we move forward, and just so everybody knows, I've actually taken off my video, so hopefully it is it's got less static and less cutting in and out. When we look at activations, there's hosting and hospitality, which I know for John and ATB, that's a big part of their work for activating on site at different events. And Jan, with the TIFF, you've got the scenario of a lot of hosting and hospitality opportunities, whether they're corporate or in the area down on King Street. So the world is going to change, and we all have to think about this. Before I go on to another question, I wanted to address something that John had mentioned, and it's key. And it recalled for me that we all know the world is going to be different, that, you know, we're not going to have those cocktail parties with a bunch of chafing dishes and you get to reach in and pick out what you want. That world is gone. The buffets are gone. So how are you going to feed people? How are you going to activate on that situation? How are you going to be able to serve food? And I watch Maple Leaf Sports and Entertainment in a partnership with Second Harvest, and the work they're doing inside Scotiabank Arena is Canada's largest kitchen, and they're producing thousands upon thousands of meals a day for frontline workers and for the Second Harvest themselves and their food bank of partners. So, but on the tops of each of those little boxes has a sticker and a logo. Hey, thanks. And it has, you know, there's sponsors on it. BMO's there, Scotiabank's there, Sun Life is there. They're all on there because they're all participating in this in some different way. So there are those types of activations. You think about events with bars, and if you're serving booze, whether it's a golf tournament or whatever else, how are you going to manage your bars when you have to have 6 feet between everybody lining up for a bar? So these are some of the things, and when we look at the virtual side that we're going to go to, and I don't care whether this is for a conference, whether it's for a festival, whether it's for a live sport event, whatever it is, that we have to, there's so many blurred lines between a virtual, what is it? Is it a webinar? Is it actually an online event? Is it a chat? What is it? And those lines are blurred. I think we're going to have to look at how we activate on those to differentiate between those. So there's a lot of those side. You've experienced some of this already, Jen, with between TIFF Bell Lightbox and TIFF itself. Can you tell everybody a little bit about what you've done towards that shift to implement opportunities at both TIFF and at TIFF Bell Lightbox?
Yeah, absolutely. And actually, it's a good reminder. I do have to tell a story at the end of what I describe here, just about what we've done with food in this time period, even when we're all at home, because there's been some interesting learnings there as well. Listen, we obviously have an incredible partnership with Bell, TIFF Bell Lightbox. They are our lead sponsor. And so it was natural that anyway, over the last years, we have been talking about what our content integration plans would be. And so we were already really proud of the launch of our Best of TIFF Shelf on Crave, which of course is Bell Media's streaming service for Canadians. And we obviously couldn't have predicted just how important that asset would end up being for us over the course of these past weeks. We were very lucky that we had officially launched that partnership in the beginning of January. So just in time for us to be able to really press go with Crave pretty quickly. Essentially over the course of 5 days, we came up with the idea to convert the really engaging and conversational audience experience that we create at TIFF by Lightbox and move that into the digital space. So we launched with about a week's notice, something called Stay at Home Cinema, which is in partnership with TIFF and Crave, which is essentially interviews that are much like the experience that you would have at TIFF live on site with talent, and some of the largest talent in the world are participating with us. We've been doing it minimum twice a week. We have the conversation on a variety of social media platforms as well as on our TIFF.net player. And then we encourage the audience to actually go watch the film on Crave. And then we actually have a discussion going while the film is playing on Twitter. So it's been an incredible, incredible experience. Like I say, kind of conceived in 5 days, launched in about a week. We've had over 500,000 engagements and over 120 million media impressions on this thing that we pulled together in a matter of a few weeks' time. So it's really shown us just, you know, what is possible when especially an organization comes together and works together on building a really robust experience, and everyone kind of gets on the bus and drives the bus in the same direction. We've done conversations with Guillermo del Toro, Ethan Hawke. We have one coming up with Kate Winslet. So it's really now looking at how do we expand this? How do we learn from this incredible thing that we've created? Learn how to expand that programming, do long form versions of it, move it across a variety of different platforms. And then of course, further integrations with our partner brands. So I think, you know, what I want to mention about the food thing that's so interesting that you mentioned, we actually just did a partnership around the film Crazy Rich Asians, which of course is an amazing film that of course broke so many records and was so timely. That came out last year. And so it actually did, it was on Crave. And so we did a conversation with the director, John M. Chu. And the conversation actually took place virtually, but our artistic director, Cameron Bailey, was at the Shangri-La Hotel for it. So the Shangri-La is one of our hospitality partners. And we also did it in partnership with Real Asian, which of course is one of the most important Asiatic focused film festivals in Canada, if not in North America. So that was an incredible experience. What we did with Shangri-La was while Cameron was speaking, and doing the introduction and having the conversation with John, you were actually able to order a Singaporean inspired dish from the Shangri-La that you could actually eat at home while you were experiencing the best of Singapore with the Crazy Rich Asians film. So it really was a very holistic experience. And so we're looking at how do we create that even more so moving forward with a variety of different types of partners. And what I will say is that, you know, it's clear to us that this only works with partners. If you don't have partners creating that touch, taste, smell experience, see experience with you, it's flat. There's just so much content out there. So how do you cut through that content? And it is by creating these really 360 experiences.
That's great. And when you look at it, I mean, we think about use of second screen really around sport, you know, watching on TV and with have my tablet beside me for stats or my phone there to be able to chat with a buddy as, did you see that? Or I can't believe he did that, you know, all that type of stuff. But using second screen and third screen for events that have gone virtual like you've done with Crave, that's fantastic.
Yeah, so, and the reality is it's going to be even more important as we start looking at contesting, dynamic ads, cross-platform social engagement models. We want to do more user-generated content. Like when we're talking about what the future of these activations can look like, that multi-screen experience is going to be critical.
It truly is. I mean, that's, and we're going to see, as you said, with all that, with the contesting, with the engagement, if you want to keep an audience, you've got to have them engaged. We already know that, and that's why sponsorship has always been so successful when it's done right. So now how do we do that virtually? John, I mean, on the brand side, how are you looking at this? What are some of the obstacles that you're encountering as you're planning? I know that you actually have a golf tournament coming up in the next couple of months, and it's going to happen. So tell us how you plan on activating, or what obstacles you're trying to overcome.
Yeah, so I'm gonna approach this two-pronged. I'm gonna tell you about the benefits of, and this will sound sad, but the benefits of COVID is at the end of the day, there are changes that are gonna happen at our events. We run a Canadian tour event, the Mackenzie Tour in Calgary. We've been involved since like 1995. Every year we have this massive parking lot, which is filled to the rim with cars, people watching, golfers, caddies, all the above. What we've identified this year is we're probably not going to have people watching, driving up and parking in our parkade, the area that we have at the golf course. So from a food standpoint and a hosting standpoint, we are actively looking at, do we increase the size of our tent, triple the size, put it on the parking lot to allow 6-foot distance travel, you know, so people can walk in safely, grab a bag lunch, sit down with their foursome at a designated table, still do some awards, that type of thing. So the benefit is we're not going to have any customers that are going to attend physically per se, like the visitors watching the tournament, but for our pro-ams, we will have the ability for our customers to still connect. So we've kind of pivoted on that a little bit, and we'll see how that ends up. But the second piece for us, which is really difficult, is every partner. We have 254 events a year. Those aren't all run by my team, but these are all key sponsorships across the province. We kind of target the larger ones. The problem that we are facing as a sponsor is the sheer volume of everyone is reacting by let's go virtual. How do I pivot my event to virtual? We actually think that at some point people are going to get a little tired of virtual, and we're going to have to really watch the sheer volume of stuff that we're trying to push out. We also deal, Jennifer, with CIF in Calgary, and they're looking at you guys and what you're doing. I know they've probably been talking to you as well. We have the Calgary Folk Fest, right? A music festival where they're talking. They're already starting, as of May 30th, some virtual interaction with their customer, with their singers. And, you know, at some point, we're quite concerned. We're not sure whether there'll be too much noise in that space. So that's one of the areas that we're really keeping an eye on. So
I would also, I'll jump in there. I would totally agree with you on that, especially in the summer months.
Yeah.
When you do have the option to go outside and it's lovely. And I think, you know, we've already even seen a difference in the amount of engagement on nicer days versus colder, rainier days. And of course, for anyone in Toronto, you know, it's been an absolutely hideous spring. I think we're jumping straight into summer. So, you know, the reality is I agree with you. I think the summer months are going to be especially difficult in terms of those content plays. But I would argue that this is not going to be the death of the internet. You know, the reality is, especially for places like Canada, come the fall, winter months, we're all cooped up regardless of a second or third wave. And I think there will be renewed interest in dynamic content. The question is, how do you cut through all the content? And how do you make that content actually unique? Because everyone is out there, as you say, trying to create new content right now. So the other thing I will add to that is that organic reach is very difficult in this environment when there is so much content. Cutting through will require an investment. There is no two ways about it. You have to do incremental investment in ad lifts. Otherwise, no matter how great you are, no matter how great your talent is, I can attest to that, you need to put some promotion behind it.
Yeah, it's so true. It is an investment. It's not free. And if you're going to do it right, and I just look at the number of studies. I just saw another message from the Canadian Sponsorship Landscape Study. They're doing phase two of their study. IMI has had six different studies. Enigma just came out with a great one specifically around events, all that sort of stuff. There's so much content out there just on research alone. And then you start talking about what you're talking about, John and Jen, about online and shifting to that virtual event, virtual conference, virtual everything, festival. And the end result is that you have to find a way to stand out. You have to find a way to stand out and differentiate your faith, yourself online, but then as an organization, but then as a sponsor, inside of that, you've got to differentiate, because sponsors are going to invest money to do this right, because they need to make an impact and they need to see that return on investment. So if they're going to run that contest, how are they going to engage and how can they interact on second and third screen? How can they be doing those sorts of things? I think they all become really critical elements to this. Jen, when you're looking at this, what are some of the obstacles that you or your partners are coming across? Actually, just before I go to that question, I want to remind everybody, and I see there's a question, I'll go through it for you in a sec, but on that right-hand side in the chat, I want to encourage everybody, if they want, this is a networking opportunity too, and we've got the second screen with the chat on the side. So if you want to, and I've done this for, so you can see, post your contact information. So if people want to connect with you on LinkedIn, or they want to connect with you on Twitter or Instagram or whatever it is, why don't you share that information? So we've got almost 200 people here. It'd be great to connect everybody with each other if they want to do so. So feel free to do that. Jen, I'm going to come back to that question around what are you and your sponsors, what are you feeling right now are the biggest obstacles in shifting presently to rejig the event and imagine those activations, whether they're online or whether they're live on site for 2020 TIFF?
It's perfect timing that you're asking that question, because I noticed Caius just asked a question that is actually very much tied to that. So, you know, I think a big concern here is how do you ensure ROI with unproven new assets? You know, we are working with various, you know, research companies to try to figure out what can these assets actually be valued at. You know, is it reasonable to value these things at certain values right now while they're untested? So the reality is we are trying to beta test as much as possible before making major new investments. We're also starting by asking the audience and stakeholders what they want, what they need, and where does that niche exist for us? We're doing tons of surveys right now. So to answer Caius's question also, what might being a hero in the digital environment look like? To be honest, we're getting a lot of feedback on that directly from our audiences right now, because we were making assumptions and, you know, some of them were accurate and actually some of them weren't things that the audience said they needed. So then we'll veer away from that in terms of the sponsor integration. Being a leader and taking risks is scary right now. So I would say there's a huge importance in piloting, in doing those beta testings before making the major new investments. And I think, you know, I will also add that, you know, volume is tricky right now. I think for a lot of organizations, in our case, you know, we've had 45 years to build the organization that we are today, and to then develop essentially new business models in a matter of weeks has been, you know, complicated, and it's been a lot of work and it's been challenging, and getting your partners to go along for the ride and trust you in that is definitely something that you need to work on. So I think, you know, handling that volume while also handling the incredible need for over communicating and a huge amount of transparency, both with your audiences and your stakeholders, has been, if not enormous challenge, then just an enormous amount of work.
Hey, great. Thanks a lot, Jen. Hey, I'm going to zip over to the Zoom chat for a sec before I go on, John. I've got a question for you too, but just beforehand, I want to ask both of you, Jen, John, and I may pump in here too, but there's a message here, a question from Lynn. Speaking of networking, thoughts on how we approach that ongoing? forward and how we move forward with networking, looking to adapt an event that has been notable networking opportunity for partners and attendees. Any thoughts on that? Like, how are you being able to take those events where you were able to have customers meet other customers, or corporate experiences where they bring their clients and network? How any ideas on how we can do that in a virtual world and in those worlds that exist right now that may be live events, but as you discussed, John, you know, three times the size of a tent?
Yeah. Do you want me to jump in first, Jen? I guess.
Sure.
Okay. I think everything's going to change. We all know that. Number one, I think technology is going to play a massive role in how we interact with not only network from a networking standpoint. It's going to be how people, you know, get information about you and your program, your events, whether it's online, like paper, that's going to be gone. People aren't going to be using that at events as takeaways, that type of thing. I think at the end of the day, like as an example for Alberta, they've limited it to 50 people max for events today, with the 2 meter separation. So we're already looking at some of our programming and identifying, you know, we used to have a space for X. Could we increase the space? And is there a comfortable way for our customers to network in a safe environment? The one thing I will say that we haven't talked about is the downside of doing it wrong, which I think is probably from a social media standpoint and a reputation standpoint, one of the biggest things that we've seen in this last 10-week pivot. As an example, we went out to Red Deer to help some truckers just last week, give them free food. We posted a photo where one of our staff was not 6 feet away from a trucker when he was standing there giving them food. And you'd be amazed at the negative feedback we got online simply because they thought that these two were not 6 feet apart. Yet we're out there, you know, giving our staff and all these customers and non-customers and farmers and truckers food just to say thank you for doing all you can do. So I think that's another aspect of this that we have to keep in the back of our mind is whatever you do from a networking standpoint, all the above, you also have to do it safely, and that we're not sure how we're going to manage that, I'll be honest. Jen, over to you.
Yeah, what we've found from an event hosting perspective is that there has not been an enormous amount of appetite to pursue anything in 2020 for exactly that reason. You don't want to be the one who gets pointed at if and when a second wave happens. And sometimes it will be entirely circumstantial. Like it'll just be the timing lines up, even if you did do everything right and it wasn't attached to you. We've seen really scary articles out there from our colleagues at other organizations that have had that finger pointed at them. And in some cases, those events were happening well before things really were heating up with COVID. So, you know, we have to be very, very cautious of that. At the same time, we also still want to try to create as many of these experiences as possible to obviously continue our mission and continue supporting our partners and stakeholders in their own objectives as well. That being said, safety is first. So we are really looking at a lot of, and again, I'm going to use the word digital versions of this. What can we create that is unique in the digital space that really does offer something special for companies to host either their key stakeholders or their employees in a more sort of VIP way. And that can include, you know, breakaway rooms, you know, with kind of influential faces, private Q&As, in our case, you know, possibly some private screenings, working with our hospitality partners on that kind of food and beverage 360 experience that would be custom tailored for our partners, you know, really kind of figuring out what's going to land. And it's not going to land for everyone. And quite frankly, those days of doing that kind of 300 person, 400 person VIP hosting experience, those days are probably going to be on hold until we actually get to the point of a vaccine or where we can be within 6 feet of each other. So I think we're all just kind of digesting that. And then we're figuring out, well, we can't do that, but what can we do? And instead of trying to force, I think we need to be cautious to try to force doing things that are of the old model. And really look at, okay, if we do have the digital space, what does the digital space offer that we couldn't do in the traditional space? And in some cases for us, the digital experience might feel even more VIP than the live experience. So we're working through that.
Thanks, Jen. Great. Sorry, go ahead, John.
Well, I was just going to say, Jen touched on it, but one of the things that I actually see one of our partners on screen, I won't mention his name, but out of Red Deer, as an example, we are also reaching out to some of our partners to say, we may not be able to deliver that large experience where we have 150 people at an event and they get to meet a hockey player, as an example. But what we have done is we're creating unique, smaller experiences, completely safe, easier to manage. One-offs where, as an example, Mark Giordano of the Calgary Flames will, you know, create a video and send it to a child, a customer's child, things like that. So that's how we've pivoted with our celebrities. And I know a lot of our hockey partners across the province, they're all completely shut down, but we've been leveraging some of their players to make some call outs to kids, that type of thing. So lots of opportunity there as well. So
I think that those are the perfect example. Jen, I think you're right too, from that perspective, that the large parties are on hold for now. I mean, you're not going to put 400 people in a room and have a cocktail party to network. And I think we're going to see the shift not only on the hospitality side and the networking side, going to smaller groups, and it could be a session, something like this, but there could be four breakout rooms on a Zoom program or whichever platform you're using. And those breakout rooms have that hockey player or that actor or the director or somebody in there that you can create those experiences brought to you by ATB or brought to you by Bell or whoever it is, and make those experiences happen. And those aren't things that you could probably get one-on-one. And so that virtual and digital world is offering those. And when we start to look at it, you can even talk about putting a group of your clients together in a session like this. It doesn't have to be like this with 200 people. It can be a discussion amongst five people because you want to break them some news or you want their opinions, and they're able to network. The other thing is that, you know, we've had up to 200 in some of the previous ones of this, you know, 250, 275 people on a session. Well, that's like having a ballroom with 275 people in it. But unfortunately, we don't say hi to each other. Kelly isn't talking to Bev, who isn't talking to Ian, who isn't talking to Dean. It's just us talking. But on that right-hand side, in that Zoom group chat area, you can do that networking. I was at a session last week, and that's where I got the idea for this, was to promote, hey, tell us your LinkedIn address, tell us your Twitter address, your Instagram address if you want, and let's connect. And so I posted mine up, and by the end of that session, I had 26 invites on LinkedIn. You know, I mean, I've got a lot of people on LinkedIn already, but this was 26 new people that wanted to connect with me and talk about networking. That's the new world how we can integrate this. Jennifer Bishop, I'm going to leave it to you to take a look. Like, all of a sudden, everybody's got questions, which is absolutely fantastic. I'm going to ask John a question, just throw this out to him, because I know it's on a lot of people, especially in the sport world's mind, from a activation side. And then I'll come back to you, and you can hopefully take a look at some of these and group them together, and got some questions for both Jennifer and John from there. But John, as we're moving towards, well, by the looks of it, in sport, and I know that ATB is quite heavily involved in sport, how how are you going to activate on those spectatorless events and those spectatorless games, whether it's hockey, whether it's CFL, if it comes back in the fall, those types of things?
Yeah. One of the other ones, Brent, was Spruce Meadows that you had mentioned a while back. So what we are trying to do is we're going to start working with our partners to try to get some behind the scenes information that people normally wouldn't get. One-on-one interviews with Coach Sutter in Red Deer, as an example. Stuff like that, that normally we wouldn't have access to. Trying to put a unique spin on a really unique environment. It's not going to be easy, like with the Stampeders, as an example. We're one of their largest sponsors in Calgary. It's not like we're going to have access to the dressing room, but I do know we have access to Coach Huff and some of the players and Bo Levi Mitchell. And there are ways for us to activate around that. And the cool part is we're probably going to reach some people that we normally wouldn't reach. Some people that maybe are just, they just go to the games and sit in the stands, but we're getting access to data that we normally didn't get from some of our partners because they're looking for ways to reach out to their customers as well. So that's one of the ways we're trying to target this, is just some digital stuff, virtual. As an example, Gord Bamford's doing an event with us in a couple weeks, and it's just 100 people. Gord's going to sing a couple songs. If people don't know Gord, he's a country music singer in Canada, top-notch guy, good community person. And he's just going to do a few songs and then take some questions. So anyways, those are the types of things we're looking at.
Oh, great. Jennifer Bishop.
Yeah. Okay. So we have one question. How do you prospect sell assets when you don't know if you have events that will happen or fans? This is coming from a youth sport organization. It's really difficult to project how many attendees will have and how they will price those assets.
I can try starting with that one because we are faced with the exact same problem right now. As I mentioned, you know, I think you have to do your best to try to estimate largely what your total impression value is going to be. I think, you know, there's obviously the importance of engagement and the direct experience of, in our case, let's say a screening, or in your case, let's say, you know, an actual like e-gaming moment. That matters, but what also matters is all of the noise that happens around it. So you have to try to quantify the totality of the coverage and the engagement and the impressions. Of course, if you work with any agencies, you can get some information around what benchmarks exist around pricing. That is something that we've been doing actively for the past couple of weeks. Digital engagements obviously have a different pricing model than deep engagements in the live space. So pricing that out will be really important to understand generally cost per impression and the different kinds of impressions that will exist. And then you have to do a best guess of how many people. And in all honesty, right now we are being very conservative. So I would rather over deliver for the partners. And then obviously we can price accordingly and grow that and scale that up as we learn more about what it is that we're actually creating and what we can do. I would also say that if you have partners who are already giving you a certain amount of money and you don't feel confident that you actually can hit that value with what you're creating in this sort of new asset mixes, have that conversation, be honest about it, and figure out what is the timeline for delivery. In many cases, it won't happen in 2020. You simply won't be able to create those assets and guarantee it. So for the sake of the relationship, think about what would a contract extension look like? What would a couple of years of a discounted experience look like? And then as you know more, obviously, you can add to that.
I would say that I agree wholeheartedly. And I think the biggest thing here that we fail to recognize, and some of this is hindsight's 2020, but if you don't have a relationship with your partners that's really deep, like if it is a transactional, you are probably not going to be able to make good on it. You're probably those sorts of things. But it comes down to, and we make our living off of doing the work that Jennifer talked about, or Jen talked about, in regards to that valuation, the difference between a digital valuation against an on-site valuation. That's part of the core of our business, and we're doing that for clients right now. But what we're also talking to them about, and I have a call with a client who's on this call, that the end result is that you need to be looking at the relationship first. Ask them what their needs are, ask them what their goals are, ask them what their objectives are, and then try to find a solution. This is no different than you would have done if you were trying to sell them an original partnership. And go back, understand what the value is to them, then determine the new value based on impressions and all that sort of stuff, and then do your best to give them what they need to achieve. And I think that if you've got partners, and John, I'm throwing this out there, and then I'm going to ask you for your candid opinion on it, but that if you're a property and you've got a partner and they say, well, listen, we still need to reach X number of clients or customers, we need to make them feel good, then my job as a property is to find a way digitally, virtually, on site, whatever it takes. It could be delivering food to them, or to their clients, or to an organization on their behalf. There's a whole bunch of ways of doing this. And the end result is, if I can make their customers feel good, it doesn't matter what the value is, per se, of the actual asset. So I think that it's the relationship and the trust that exists today between you and your partner that will help you get through with creating those digital and virtual assets, or other assets that you have to create. John, how would you react to that?
Yeah, I'm complete agreement. You know, the interesting thing for us is we have stuck by a few of our, we've had obviously quite a few events canceled for the summer. We have stuck by a few of our partners, even though they're not going to be able to deliver on what we had in our contract. For the simple reason that they're going to do their best, and we want to be there when we come out of this on the other end. So that's been something that we kind of put a line in the sand and said, we do not, this is unprecedented times. We did not want to walk away. I can use an example of the Fringe in Edmonton. They have, I think it's the second largest Fringe festival in North America, if not the world. I think Edinburgh might be the number one. They showed us their books and told us, if you guys walk away, we may not be able to make some, you know, we may not be able to continue on with some of our programming. We turned around and said, we want to be here for you in the long term. We've had a great relationship. Let's keep moving forward. So I think it comes down to communication and talking to your partners, identifying what they need for you to continue to partner and work with them. And I think it's all about talking to them. And I think the worst thing that we can see is somebody afraid to make that call to me and say, John, we're in dire straits. We need some help. I'd rather hear that than not hear from you. So.
Yeah. I would add also, when you're on the property side, it is so important to recognize also that many of your partners are also going through very, very challenging times. So we need totally. To each other. We need to be patient with each other. You know, we went out the gates 2 weeks after lockdown and went to our partners and said, okay, we're going to need to know what your new go-to-market strategy is, because we need to figure out if we're going to be tonally aligned in what we want to do moving forward. And they all came back and said, listen, we haven't figured it out either. And, you know, you have to realize sometimes as a nonprofit, or as a on the property side, you think your partners have it all figured out, but in this case, they really don't. So we need to work together on rebuilding everything and have that level of patience. And as you say, John, just over communication at this point is better than under communication.
I am so glad both of you keep focusing on that communication element. And we've been saying this since Jennifer, since we did the first session with you on March 21st, is it's about communication. Don't, as a property, come out with some great plans and say, here's what we're going to do for you, if you haven't talked to your partners yet. don't start making plans till you've talked to your partners. And if you're a brand, same thing goes. You need to be talking. If you might have these great activation plans, but the property may be taking a whole different tact. They may not be going virtual. They may be going live. They may be not going live. So the communication is so essential. I know we're down to about 5 or 6 minutes here, Jennifer. What I want to do is, I encourage everybody to share on the side, and we'll try to share. Jen, is there any way you can get this chat column out too and share it to those that were on the session, or how do you want to go about that? We'll take a look. We'll see how we might be able to do that. And it might be, and I don't think, Jen, you want 170 emails, but Jennifer, I don't think you want 170 or 200 emails. But one option might be, you know, hey, please send that list to me if you weren't able to connect live on it while it's up and operating right now. I would also like to, I'm going to go, there's a whole bunch of questions there that we haven't answered. And if you want to reach out to myself, or you want to reach out to Jen or John specifically, or Jennifer Bishop over at Toronto Region Board of Trade, feel free to do so with your questions directly to them as well. But I want to kind of go to one last question to each of you. Jen, what's the biggest learning experience you've had over these past 10 weeks or so with rejigging the event, with changes, with partners, with everything that's going on? What's, from an activation side, what's the biggest thing you've learned?
I think, you know, there are kind of three key learnings, actually. One is that you absolutely can't just move live engagements into digital and expect it to work. You need to completely rework most assets for the digital space. Figure out what are the great points of digital, what are the unique points of digital, and how do you lean into that? Otherwise, as I keep saying to my team, it's like bludgeoning a square peg into a round hole. And it won't be a great experience. So take the time to test drive your theories around what a digital activation can look like before you put it out into the world in a mass way. And then I'd also add that, you know, if you, like I said, that whole idea of not feeling confident about being able to deliver the full value of assets with partners, in some cases you might actually be able to do that. So really get as creative as possible. I think now is the time that there will be a lot of patience and forgiveness out in the world. So when you go and speak with your partners, have a really crazy brainstorming session. Have that really blue sky session, because some really tangible ideas might come out of that, and everyone might actually get a lot of value out of those experiences. And then the last thing I would say is that, you know, personalization is proving to be extremely key, especially in order to cut through all of the noise of all the content that's getting out there. People really want to see the humanity of brands, real faces in real time, having people feel connected and less isolated. And I think doing that in a way that also doesn't feel disingenuous and doesn't feel like the, you know, everyone's, you know, unprecedented situation, using that same language, you know, really kind of figuring out what does that mean for your organization, for your brands, and how can you really bring that to life in a really natural and authentic way.
I'm up, I guess.
You are, sir.
You know, the one thing I would say that we have learned out of this is, number one, you need to be able to, and I'm sure you guys have heard this phrase so much lately, but we need to be able to pivot. And we pivoted the day that everything was canceled. We pivoted immediately, analyzed every partner event program that we had, and identified, you know, it kept my team busy probably for an entire month just to identify what are the contract commitments we have made? Are we still paying? Are we shifting? What are we doing? So that was number one. And the second piece, which I think people have forgotten in this, well, maybe not, but is that every time there is a tragedy or something goes wrong, there's an opportunity for your organization to show your true colors. I'm extremely proud of the work that we have done, and numerous partners and other banks too. I will give every bank that I've seen out there doing good work, and every other sponsor. We've been out there supporting frontline workers, truckers, teachers, you name it, trying to help out where we can basically taking money from canceled events and transferring that over. So I think for us that there's an ability, even in a tragedy, perfect example, Fort McMurray, and I know you all know that they had a massive fire there a few years ago, and they just had a massive flood about 3 weeks ago. So we pivoted and said, these guys are in dire straits. They're going to need clothing. They're going to need all the above. We turned around and called three of our partners. They got us $20,000 worth of clothing. We paid a percentage of that, shipped it up with a trucking company, and it was delivered to people in need. And that's the, you know, the tough part of these times is how you respond to problems. But I also think it's a great time to show your true mettle. And anyways, proud of probably many of the people that are on this call, the work you've done in your communities to support people. But I think that's also another aspect of this that we're forgetting.
Thanks very much. Thanks, John, for that. Thanks, Jen. I just wanted to wrap up here, and then I'll turn it back to Jennifer Bishop. A couple of things. Number one, Jennifer Bishop and Toronto Region Board of Trade are going to take this, as you saw, it was being recorded. They will get me the video, and I will then post it on our website at partnershipgroup.ca. You'll be able to access that. It's Thursday today. I'm going to be honest with you, it'll probably be over the weekend or Monday by the time it gets up there. But just go to partnershipgroup.ca and you'll be able to take a look at it, go back. Should also be able to access the Zoom group chat at that point too, to be able to click on anybody that you want for LinkedIn or otherwise. I would also like to, of course, thank both panelists, John and Jen. Thank you both and for all the great insights. This was an amazing session. I really appreciate it. And thank you to Jennifer Bishop and the Toronto Region Board of Trade for hosting this. If it wasn't for you guys and the initiative back in March to make this happen, and run one in March, another one in April, another one in May here, that we wouldn't be able to share the ways we have. So, and of course, finally, thanks to everybody that's been on this, the 200 or so almost people that were on this call today, and the several hundred that have been on. For the others, thanks for being here, because it isn't worth doing unless you're here. So thanks again, and turn it over to you, Jennifer Bishop. Thank you.
Yay. Thank you, everyone. I echo Brent. If you want to stay connected, you want to hear more of these free webinars, let me know what kind of content you want, any specific speakers. I will happily work with Brent or whoever and make these happen. Have a great day. Thanks for tuning in. Stay safe. And if you're in the rain, stay dry. Thank you, everybody. Bye.
What?